the big finding here is that although we knew that there were COVID-19 virus in the oral cavity, in saliva specifically, we didn't really know where that was coming from, where the virus was coming from. And we didn't know if the virus was in saliva, if it was infectious. And so in fact, we showed both of those things. We showed that the mucosa and also the salivary glands can be infected with SARS-CoV-2, the virus that causes COVID-19. And we showed that the virus could replicate in the salivary glands specifically to produce more virus. And if the mouth is making more copies of the virus, then that virus can spread inside your body to other organs, such as your stomach or to your lungs through what we call microaspirations. And I think that's a critical component of understanding the pathophysiology of COVID-19. We were lucky enough to have a couple patients who donated their saliva, who were entirely asymptomatic, but had extremely high viral loads. We used their saliva to infect cells outside of the body. These are cells grown in a dish. And in fact, the virus was able to infect those cells and replicate. And that was the key piece of information that tells us that an individual with absolutely no symptoms feels fine, can walk right into a grocery store or into a library, could potentially spread high levels of virus either by talking or breathing in that environment, and that those droplets would be potentially infectious. Our data really supports that wearing a mask prevents infectious saliva from being transmitted or dispensed to other people. So for everyday people, wearing a mask, especially when you're in social situations where you're having to talk to people or you're going to be in close proximity, wearing a mask does protect the other individuals in the room from the person who's wearing a mask and might potentially be infected. While we didn't test taste buds themselves for the virus, what we found is clinical data, symptom data, that in fact showed that patients who have an infection in their oral cavity, that there is virus in saliva, they were much more likely to lose their sense of taste or smell. And why that is important is it gives us or helps us generate the hypothesis that in fact, virus not only infects the mucosa or the lining of the mouth or the salivary glands, but can probably also infect the taste buds. And if you have an infection in the taste buds, there is the potential that the immune system or the virus itself may disrupt the normal communication between the taste bud and your brain. So interrupting your sense of taste or your sense of smell. Yes, I think we were really lucky in that we studied saliva. We studied the mouth, and we had this idea that the mouth might be involved in the pathogenesis of COVID-19. But we didn't know how we could see patients because our hospital was closed, our clinic was closed, and my lab was closed, and we did have to get creative. And part of this came from this opportunity that we had thousands of employees at NIH, and that unfortunately some of them might contract SARS-CoV-2. And some of those individuals may in fact have to report to work as a frontline healthcare provider. And so NIH, I think very smartly, set up a drive-through testing facility. And this drive-through testing facility provided the infrastructure to basically permit employees to come through to have their COVID testing done. And we saw this as an opportunity to do a clinical study in parallel to that clinical testing facility. I think the idea that the oral cavity and associated tissues are vulnerable to not just COVID-19, but to many other viruses is a critical piece of data that we are showing. Our single cell atlas, so to speak, gives everyone a map, a very basic map for what cell types may be infected by various types of viruses. And I think from a preparedness standpoint, the next pandemic, and you know, we don't want to talk yet about the next pandemic, but the truth is that eventually, some year, we're going to go through this again, either in our lifetime or the next. And having some of these tools will help us even more rapidly than we addressed COVID-19, address that next pandemic.